Today we are going to have a presentation on a topic which falls in this paper, Indian Politics, paper one. And the module title is The Executive in India. This module has been written by Professor Narendra Kumar, who is a JNU professor in the Center for Political Studies. And the paper coordinator is Professor Ajay Mehra. I'm Professor Ashutosh Kumar. I'm a national coordinator for EPG Pathshala. So in this module, we would know about the office of the President of India. We would also discuss about the relationship between the President and the Prime Minister, or you can say the relationship between the President and the Council of Minister. So first we should understand that in India we have got a parliamentary form of government. We don't have a presidential form of government. So what's the difference between the two? In a parliamentary form of government, the Council of Ministers is collectively responsible to the parliament. And the ministers as well as the Prime Minister should be the member of the parliament, either to the Lok Sabha or the Raj Sabha. As you know, parliament in India is a bicameral parliament. So if a person is not a member of the parliament and is a minister, within 6 months, he or she should get elected to either of the house of the parliament, or even if he is nominated. As you know, in the Lok Sabha, the two members from the Anglo-Indian community can be nominated by the president. In the Raj Sabha, there is a provision of the nomination of 12 members for showing excellence in the field of art, science, literature, social service. Even a nominated member or elected member, I mean, the membership is must to remain a minister in a parliamentary form of government. And so there is a close relationship between the parliament or the legislature and the executive, which is not the case with the American presidency, where the president is directly elected by the people and there is a clear demarcation between the executive and the American Congress, in the sense that the secretaries or the ministers, they are called secretaries there in US, they are not members of the Senate or the House of Representatives in the America, in US polity. Now, in India, the president is elected indirectly. India is a democratic republic. What does it mean? One of the features of a republic is that the elected, the head of the state should be elected person. So President of India is elected, but and also when India is called a republic, it means that everyone has the right, every citizen of India has the right to compete for, to stand for any political office, including the office of the President of India. So there is a kind of equal citizenship. There is no differentiated citizenship in terms of the opportunity to hold any public office, and refer to Article 16 of the Constitution of India in this regard, and also Article 14, right to equality. Now, President of India is indirectly elected. Why the President of India is indirectly elected? President of India is indirectly elected because a directly elected president would have been too powerful, and there would have been two power center in the Indian polity. Like the Prime Minister would have been one power center and the president would have been another power center. But please understand that the president is elected by an electoral college which is fairly representative. Like you know that the president is elected by an electoral college which consists of the elected members of, I'm saying elected members, I'm not including the nominated member, elected members of Lok Sabha, elected members of Raj Sabha, and elected members of Vidhan Sabha. Here you must remember that I am not referring to the members of the Vidhan Parishad. So I repeat, the electoral college to elect the president of India consists of elected members of Lok Sabha, elected members of Raj Sabha, as well as the elected members of Vidhan Sabha. The election takes place on the basis of proportional representation, single transferable vote system. Single transferable vote system is also can be explained by the preferential voting. So suppose there are, if there are four candidates in the fray, then every elector would have four choices. So he has to make the choices like first choice, second choice, third choice, fourth choice. And in the first counting, only the first choice is taken into consideration. And after the first counting, first stage of counting, and considering only the first choice votes, if a candidate gets the majority of the vote, then the person is elected, declared as elected. Otherwise, what happens is that the person who has got the least number of the first preference vote, his ballots are taken out, and then the second preference votes are counted. And the second preference vote becomes the first preference vote. So it's transferred to the person who has got the second preference vote. So this way, it can go to the second stage, third stage. In the history of India, it has happened only once, when in 1969, V.V. Giri and Neelam Sanjeeva Reddy contested the election for the president. Neelam Sanjeeva Reddy was the official candidate of the Congress, and V.V. Giri was independent candidate. And the counting went to the second stage, and ultimately it was V.V. Giri who was independent candidate, or you can say rebel candidate, who was being supported by the then Prime Minister Indira Gandhi and her supporters. He won the election in a closely contested fight. So otherwise, it has been always been like the first counting, or the president like Neelam Sanjeeva Reddy was elected without any contest. So this was the first thing I wanted to say. And I can also say that the Indian system is also, Indian parliamentary system is also known by the cabinet system, because the cabinet plays such an important role. It dominates even the parliament in terms of the policy making decisions and all. So the president, what is the role of the president? Is the president a rubber stamp? Is the president merely a kind of a constitutional figure? No, it would be wrong to say this. President is of course a nominal de jure head of the government. He's not the de facto head of the government. De facto head of the government is the prime minister, whosoever is the prime minister. So prime minister is the actual head of the government, and the president is just a kind of a nominal head. When we refer to the powers of the president, we should understand that the president has got the executive power. So all the executive powers of the center is exercised in the name of the president. But then the president, can president take his own decisions? No. There are certain articles in the constitution which are very instructive. For example, Article 74 of the Constitution of India. Article 74 says there shall be a council of ministers with the Prime Minister at its head to aid and advise the President, who shall act in accordance with such advice. It is very clear by reading this text, which was there in the 1950 Constitution itself, that the president is supposed to. So the 1950 text was that there shall be a council of ministers with the prime minister at its head to aid and advise the president. So it was very clear even in 1950 Constitution that the president should act on the advice of the council of ministers. In fact, there was a confusion also, as if you refer to Granville Austin book, it is very clear that the first president of India, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, had some problem with regard to the first constitutional amendment. He also had a problem with regard to the Hindu Civil Code Bill, and he had sought the permission, the advice of the then Attorney General about the position of the president in relation to the prime ministerial advice. And he was said that the post of the president of India was very much like the British monarch, who is also the constitutional head. In fact, the constitutional experts say that Indian presidency is comparable to the Irish presidency in terms of the powers and all. So, Article 74 and 42nd Amendment 1976 makes it explicit by saying that the president shall act on the advice of the Council of Ministers. So it is very clear now that the president has to act on the advice of the Council of Ministers. But if you refer to the 44th Amendment, there was another addition, 44th Amendment 1978, which said that the president can refer the matter for the reconsideration of the Council of Ministers. That means what? That means that the president has got at least one discretion, that if there is an advice given to him by the Council of Ministers, the president, if president has some problem or some reservation about the advice being given to him by the Council of Ministers, he can refer the matter to the Council of Ministers for the reconsideration. But if the Council of Ministers comes out with the same advice again, then the President has no choice but to accept the advice. So Article 74 makes it very clear that the President basically acts on the advice of the Council of Ministers. So the executive power of the President should be seen in that context. So Article 53 says that the executive power of the Union shall be vested in the office of the President. But then if you refer to the 44th Amendment and 42nd Amendment and also the 1950 text, as I told you, it is very clear that the President is bound by the advice of the Council of Ministers. But there are many important appointments which are made by the President, like the office of this Comptroller and Auditor General of India, CAG, is appointed by the President. The Chief Election Commissioner, the Election Commissioners in the Election Commission of India under Article 324, they are appointed by the President. The President also appoints the Attorney General of India. Attorney General, who is also known as the first law officer, holds office during the pleasure of the President. His salary and the emoluments are determined by the President. So the post like Attorney General, the Comptroller and Auditor General, Election Commissioner, Chief Election Commissioner, UPSC, Union Public Service Commission members, Union Public Service Commission chairman, they all are appointed by even the State Public Service Commission members can be removed only by the President of India. And the President also makes other appointments like the members of the National Commission for Scheduled Caste, National Commission for Scheduled Tribe, also the National Commission for Women. So all those appointments are made by the President of India. Not to forget, the President of India also appoints the judges of the High Court, judges of the Supreme Court. They can be removed also only by the President. Of course, there is a proper procedure. There has to be a motion of impeachment passed against them. So that way the President has got the executive power. But as I said again and again, that the President has to act on the advice of the Council of Ministers. Now we come to the legislative powers of the President. President, remember, when we talked about the Parliament, the President is part of the Parliament. So Parliament consists of Lok Sabha, Raj Sabha and the President. Now, the President has got the many powers, like the President can summon the session of the Parliament. The President dissolve Lok Sabha on the advice of the Council of Ministers. President can address the joint session of the both houses of the Parliament. President can address also a special session, can call a special session and address the joint session. President can also address an individual house, or President can always send the message to the Parliament which has to be considered. President can address also a special session, can call a special session and address the joint session. President can also address an individual house, or President can always send the message to the Parliament which has to be considered. Now, here you must understand that there has been a convention that the President addresses the joint session of the both houses of the Parliament on two occasions. One, when a new Lok Sabha is reconstituted, the first sitting is always the joint session where the Raj Sabha, Lok Sabha members sit in the Darbar Hall and there the central hall, and where the President addresses them. The second time, opportunity when the President addresses the joint session of the Parliament is the first session of every new year. So these are the formal occasions when the President reads the message, the speech prepared by the Council of Ministers. But the President can also, as I said, President can always call the special session. In fact, the President's power is to call the joint session of the both houses if there is a deadlock on any ordinary bill, because as we know that if there is a constitutional deadlock, like the Lok Sabha and Raj Sabha not agreeing on any ordinary bill, President would be within his right to call. It's not binding, but the President may call joint session of the both houses of the Parliament to break the deadlock. So this way you can see that the President has lots of powers. President also nominates the two members, as I said, from the Anglo-Indian community in the Lok Sabha. President can also nominate 12 members in the Raj Sabha for showing excellence in the field of art, science, literature and social service. All the legislative bills can become law only when they receive the assent of the President. Now, what happens if a legislative bill, if there is an ordinary bill which is passed by the Parliament, goes to the President? President has the following choices. President can give his assent, the bill shall become law. President can withhold his assent, the bill shall not become law. The President can ask the Parliament to reconsider the bill, and if the Parliament reconsiders the bill and passes the bill again in the original form or in the amended form, then the bill would again go to the President, and this time President would have no choice but to give his assent. As far as the money bill is concerned, the money bill can be introduced in the Parliament only with the prior recommendation of the President. Another bill, if there is is a bill under Article 3, which refers to the creation of a new state, or altering the boundary of the state, or, say, changing the name of the state, or like that. Then such kind of bills, which aims at the creation of a new state or altering the boundary of the state, would need prior recommendation of the president. So you have, like, the legislative powers with the president. The president also has got the emergency powers under Article 352, 356 and 360. And here you'll find that the president can proclaim the national emergency. There's no word like national. There's a, like, Article 352 says that the emergency can be declared in the whole of the country or in the part of the country. President can proclaim emergency. President can revoke the proclamation of the emergency anytime. When there is a national emergency, then the federal government gets the concurrent power to make law on a state subject, and also the union executive can give direction to the states with regard to even the state subject. And when there is a national emergency, the tenure of the Lok Sabha can be also extended for 1 year at one go under Article 358 if there is a national emergency. And if the national emergency has been declared on the basis of external war or a threat of external war, then the right to liberty as given under Article 19 gets automatically suspended. Under Article 359, if there is an emergency proclaimed under Article 352, this is also called national emergency, then the president can issue a separate proclamation suspending the fundamental rights of, with the exception of the rights given under Article 20 and under rights given under Article 21. Except the fundamental rights given under Article 20 and 21, the president can suspend all the other fundamental rights. So that is also the right of the president. But please understand that the president can use his emergency powers only on the advice of the Council of Ministers. In fact, under Article 352, it is clearly written that the president has to make a proclamation of national emergency on the written recommendation of the cabinet ministers. That is 44th Constitutional Amendment, 1978. And also it is written that the proclamation of the president shall come to an end if the proclamation does not receive the approval of the Lok Sabha and the Raj Sabha within 1 month from the date of the proclamation. If the Lok Sabha stands dissolved, then whenever the Lok Sabha meets within 30 days, it needs to approve the proclamation by special majority. That is 2/3 members present and voting, and that should be more than half of the total strength of the House. Then when there is another power which has been very much contentious power, and that is the power to make proclamation for a state emergency under Article 356. Here again the president, as S.R. Bommai case Supreme Court said, that the president is supposed to have the report of the governor with regard to whether there has been a failure of the constitutional order in the state under question or not. Even if the governor, governor report should be there with the president, but governor report is not binding on the president. Even if the governor does not recommend the proclamation of the state emergency or the president's rule, the president can go ahead and proclaim the president's rule in that state. When the president's rule is imposed, the state government is dismissed and the executive power of the state gets vested in the office of the president. And president can delegate his executive power to the governor and also to the advisor to perform the executive task. And then the legislative power during the period gets vested in the parliament. Parliament can make law even on the state subject with regard to the state which is under the president's rule. So basically, if you can see that whether it's an emergency under Article 352 or 356, the central state relations undergoes a great change, and in fact, for all practical purposes, Indian polity becomes unitary polity. Under Article 360, the president also has got the power to make a proclamation of financial emergency to ensure financial stability. So if there is a financial crisis in any part of the country or whole of the country, then the president can proclaim financial emergency. And during the financial emergency, president can direct the state government to follow the canons of financial propriety. In fact, all the money bills, even if they have been duly passed by the state legislature, has to be reserved for the assent of the president. The salaries of the state government employees can be altered also to their disadvantage by the direction of the president. So that way, and the salaries of the judges of the High Court, Supreme Court can be reduced, which are otherwise secured. They cannot be altered during their tenure, but during financial emergency, the parliament can make law reducing their salary and the emoluments. Now, as you know, the emergency powers of the president has been critiqued a lot. It has been said that the federal structure becomes a unitary, the fundamental rights get suspended, and also the democratic ethos, like right to freedom and right to seek constitutional remedy under Article 32, they all go for a toss. So there has been a lot of resentment with regard to this thing. Now, the relationship between the Prime Minister and the President, you must refer to Article 78. Article 78 says that it shall be the duty of the Prime Minister to inform the President about any administrative decisions or any legislative measures which are being contemplated by the government. President also may ask the Prime Minister about any administrative decisions which are being contemplated, which are going to be taken up by the government, or any legislative measures being contemplated by the government. So in both cases, either the Prime Minister on his own or on her own should give the information to the President, or if the President asks for such information, then the Prime Minister should supply the information. And the basic idea would be, and this article was always there in 1950 Constitution itself, the basic idea would be that if the Prime Minister takes into confidence the President can also give him his peace of mind and his advice, because President is supposed to be an eminent person, a very experienced person. Then Article 78 also says that if a decision has been taken by an individual minister, then the President can ask the Council of Ministers to reconsider the decision. And if the Council of Ministers reconsiders the decision, comes out with the same decision, then obviously the President is bound to accept the advice of the Council of Ministers. Likewise, the ordinance making power also, the President is given the responsibility to issue the ordinance when the parliament is not in session, or even when only one house is in session, the other house is not in session. So the ordinance making power also is with the President. The President has also got the power to pardon or to commute a sentence. And remember, only the President and not the governor of a state has got the power to pardon a death sentence. After discussing all these powers of the President, let us discuss about how President of India, successive Presidents of India, you remember only Dr. Rajan Prasad was the only person who had two successive terms, tenure as the President. Otherwise, all the other Presidents had only one term, and Fakhruddin Ali Ahmad and Jakir Hussain were the two Presidents who died in office. They could not complete their tenure. And, you know, some Presidents have been much more active than other Presidents. Some Presidents have been copybook Presidents, other Presidents have been activist Presidents. If you refer to the President Venkatraman or President K.R. Narayanan, they were very active Presidents. There were occasions when they referred the matter again to the Council of Ministers for the reconsideration. And in fact, they were not really, like, especially Venkatraman was quite assertive as the President. And here you must understand, whenever the government is a coalition government, whenever the government is weak government, then the President office becomes very important. For example, if no party gets a clear-cut majority in the Lok Sabha, which has been the case for many, many years, I mean, the trend ended only in 2014, because after 1985 elections, no party got a clear-cut majority in the Lok Sabha. So even the Narasimha Rao government in 1991 was a minority government. They got majority after 2-3 years, managing the defection from Jharkhand Mukti Morcha and other parties. So in the case of the minority government, in the case of the coalition government, in the case of the weak prime minister, the office of the president becomes very, very important, as you refer to James Manner, Balveer Arora, all these people, those who have worked on this presidency, Ajay Mehra, they all have spoken about how the office of the president becomes very critical. Like Article 75 says that the president shall be appointing the leader of the majority party in the Lok Sabha as the prime minister. So there have been occasions where no party has got a clear-cut majority. So Shankar Dayal Sharma, for example, in 1996, appointed Atal Bihari Vajpayee to become the prime minister on the basis that Atal Bihari Vajpayee was the leader of the largest party, BJP. But Atal Bihari Vajpayee had to resign after 13 days because he could not prove his majority. There was another occasion when Nilam Sanjeeva Reddy was the president of India, and after Morarji Desai resigned and Charan Singh became the prime minister, and Charan Singh also resigned before facing the vote of confidence in the Lok Sabha, then there was a possibility that Jagjeevan Ram could have been considered as the president, but Nilam Sanjeeva Reddy decided to dissolve the Lok Sabha and call for the fresh election. So there are occasions when no party is getting clear-cut majority, then whom to be invited to be appointed as the prime minister? Because the president has to ensure that whosoever is appointed as a prime minister should be able to give a stable government. And there the role of the president becomes very, very important. So all these things we can discuss about, and we can say that the president is not merely a kind of constitutional head, rather the president can play a very active role in the case of a coalition government, in the case of a weak government, and president can always put forward his moral authority. And fortunately in India we have had very eminent persons as the president, the people like Pranab Mukherjee, then Rajendra Prasad, Dr. Sarvepalli, Radhakrishnan. They all were really very eminent persons in their Jati Hussain, also a famous educationist. These people were seasoned politicians or educationists and shown excellence in the field of their expertise. And that way the office of the president has been well received, has been well respected. This is a post like, you know, nobody really thinks about the impeachment of the president, though there is a provision in the constitution that president can be impeached by absolute majority, that is the two-thirds of the total membership of the both houses of the parliament, and you have to give a 14 days notice for the impeachment, and the president can be impeached only on the basis of proved misbehavior or incapacity. So that way you can say that there has never been a question about impeachment of the president or even criticism of the president. So we can say that the office of the president has really been very crucial for the working of the parliamentary federal polity of India, and the president, the position, power and position of the president has been well conceived and well exercised by the successive presidents of India. Thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed this module.